Listen, I know I'm the only one in this room who's ever had problems and has any troubles going on or anything like that. But I'm glad he's my anchor in the time of storm, okay? And if he's not your anchor tonight, you can make him your anchor. Now listen very carefully. Here's what I want us to pray before we get started. Jamie's getting ready to come. I want you to pray with me that God will speak boldly, loudly, and clearly. And that he will make us say yes. Did you hear what I said? That he would make us say yes. Lord, whatever it is, you're calling us, yes. Pray with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, right now, I just want to say thank you for Jamie Ragel. Thank you for your servant who faithfully and tirelessly travels sharing the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that right now you would place your hand upon him. I pray, God, for the anointing of your spirit to flow from the top of his head to the soles of his feet. God, as he opens his mouth, you speak through him tonight to us, your people. We need a fresh word from you. God, we're asking tonight that you speak loudly, boldly, and clearly. God, make us say yes to you. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Did you hear my bones pop just now? Did you hear that? I thought maybe I was the only one who heard that. These old bodies, they wear out, don't they? That's actually a question. They wear out, don't they? Hey, did you enjoy that song? About three of them did, ladies. I'm sorry. I was very blessed by it. Did you enjoy that song? Okay. See, I don't get that because if the volunteers are playing football down here at UT Stadium, you're screaming and pulling your hair out and jumping up and down. I mean, there's some things worth shouting about, and it sure ain't the volunteers. I can tell you that for sure. Now, the Wildcats of Kentucky, now that's a horse of a different color. I enjoyed it so much. You know, I was talking to a friend of mine the other day, and he was talking about this lady, movie star, beautiful, beautiful lady. He says, but you know, there's something about her that just, I can't put my finger on it, makes her so unattractive. I said, I know what it is. It's pride. She's full of herself. She thinks she's better than other people. And folks, you may not believe this, but I believe the single greatest sin in all the world is pride. People who think they're better than other people because of where they live. Margo and I live on the fifth hole of the golf course. First of all, nobody cares. People talk about things that are just not even relevant. And they feel like perhaps they're more important because of their education. You know, the Bible says one of the things that will earmark this generation is that they're ever learning but not able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Do you understand what that means? We live in a world that's filled with technology. We have the ability. It's really interesting. Dr. Falwell told me, he said, Jamie, he said, mark my words, there's going to come a time when with just the stroke of a keystroke, we'll be able to send messages around the world. And sure enough, that time has come. The world is smarter than it's ever been, and yet farther away than they've ever been. Folks, we are a godless nation. We celebrate immorality and impurity. And even people on television who name Jesus or speak the name of God, who are living lives that are just like so inconsistent. Can I tell you one of the things that blessed me about that song tonight? were the ladies that sang it. In particular, now can I just tell you, I've sang with a Grammy-nominated group. I've traveled and sang around the world. I've heard better singers than those two ladies. But I'm telling you, I didn't see those ladies. I saw him. You know, I had a lady in my church in Tampa. She would always come and say, several people have been asking me to sing. Who are they? And the truth is, people tell me I'm a great teacher. Well, they've lied to you. Let another man praise you and not your own lips. Can I say that one more time? Let another man praise you and not your own lips, a stranger and not your own mouth. And can I just be the first to tell you, preachers are among some of the most proud, arrogant, mindless people in the world. John told me the other day, he says, you don't act like a preacher.
I'm not walking around like this, amen, amen, brother. Hey, Brother Beasley here, amen.
I'm not walking around like, say,
do you want to go to hell?
Well, not this afternoon, I don't. Did you ask a question like that?
Let me ask you this, friend, do you want to burn in a Christless hell?
That's not on my day timer. And folks, listen, do you know if there is a place where we ought to check our pride, it should be at the door of the church. So when people come in, they feel welcome. There are people that make more money here than some other people. There are people who have more education than others. There are people who are in better physical condition, not than me, but... It just, dude, I hate,
hey, you know what, man? Like I'm bench pressing like 480 now.
P-R-I-D-E. How did that enrich me? Folks, when you speak to someone, speak into their life. Don't talk about yours. You know, I feel that I'm one of the best. Well, then you're not. You're not. What's tragic is God has given this great life to all of us, and he's told us how to live this life. And I mentioned the other night, the reason so many of us don't enjoy this life, it's not because it's impossible, but we just won't do what God says to do to enjoy it. Folks, there's not one person here that God loves any more than you. The most unimportant thing...
Well, I'm a Baptist. Hey, bad.
You know what's fun?
I'm a Pentecostal, amen. I'm a Nazarene. I go to the Church of Christ, amen.
Do you know the most unimportant thing in all the world to God is the name on the outside of your church? That means absolutely, huh? But boy, there are people proud of that. Yes, they are. There's a church in Tennessee that I've been talking to. They want me to be their pastor. Been talking to them. And people don't understand this, folks. In church, where people can hear what you're saying. And so I'm in the church and talking to a couple of folks. This cool guy and his wife just got saved. Man, been in the drug world. And I mean got saved. I mean saved. They're living the exchange life. And this is what I heard. That's him, I think. That's that brother Ragles. Jamie Ragles. First of all, that's wrong. I didn't say that. Her friend said, that's him. And you know what I heard? I've heard that he's not even a Baptist.
I've seen him raise his hands before. If he becomes the pastor here, they'll be clapping. There'll be people jumping up and down. You watching. They might even be shouting. I'm telling you that. He may not even stop at snakes. They might bring in snakes.
Now, I embellished that just a bit. But she did say,
I've heard that he's not even a Baptist.
So you know what I did? And folks, listen, there's nothing wrong with righteous pride. There's nothing wrong being proud of your kids. But let's get this straight. Your kid is no more better than nobody else's kid. Can I, Can I get a, I know that's right. I know that's right. Some of your kids need to be tased. They just need to be tased. If I talked in church, Dr. Stewart, my mother would leave the choir, come down and drag me out and heal me. You could hear the healing going on outside the door. People now will sit in church and let their kids scream and throw popcorn. Whew. First of all, the preacher has done all this work to prepare a sermon. They don't need to hear the children of the corn while the message is going on. And you know what? The problem's not the kid. Huh? The problem ain't the kid.
Well, my son is, I just don't feel comfortable about putting him in the nursery.
That's code for you think your son is better than all the other little boys that go in the nursery. See, I don't mind saying what nobody else will say. If you have cats in your house stinks. Now, you need to know that. Cats go to the bathroom in the house. In a container in the house.
Well, I have a cat. My house don't stink. Yeah, it does. Yeah, it does.
Probably mad at me now, aren't you? Do you have your Bible? I won't be long or boring. I want to speak tonight for just a few moments on the single greatest sin in all the world. The single greatest sin in all the world. 2 Kings, if you have your Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, 2 Kings.
He must have one of those new Bibles.
Hey, folks, you ought to come to church with a Bible. Or an iPad that has a Bible. Or a phone that has a Bible. We don't bring Bibles to church. I know, because you have yours memorized. If you won't bring a Bible to church, if I were a betting man, I bet you don't even crack one all week when you're at home. Mm-hmm. And if you're in the ministry, you ought to really have a Bible. What are you going to do when one of your kids or one of your teenagers or one of your parishioners or church members says, I want to know what the Bible says about this?
Well, I would tell you, but I didn't bring mine.
I'd do a Donald Trump on you. You're fired. You're fired. Mm-hmm. In 2 Kings chapter 5, follow with me, verse 1. Let's just start right at the top of the text. The king of Aram had great admiration for Naaman. He was the commander of his army, and because through him the Lord had given Aram great victories. Stop right there for a minute. Now, you can already tell the king is proud of Naaman. Naaman is an accomplished warrior. Naaman has a lot he could brag about. And you'll see he does just that. He has the opportunity at that point perhaps to just kind of stand off to the side and say he's everything. I'm everything that he says I am. But you know what, folks? If you're taking notes, here's something we all need to know. No matter how great you think you are, there's always something that flaws our character. There are no people in this building who are perfect. There are no people in this building without sin. There are no people in this building who don't make mistakes and do wrong. That's why, listen, I just don't get it. I have never, one of my pet peeves, and you heard me say this the other day.
I got this black buddy named Daryl.
How come you just don't have this buddy named Daryl? Why do I have to know he's your black buddy?
Well, I got this Mexican friend named Jose. His brother's name is Jose B.
What, let me ask you a question. Why is it important that I know that your friend is Mexican? Now, folks, I'm telling you, any way you slice this, it's a subtle way of you wanting me to know that there's something that makes you different than him. Do you think God cares anything about that? Do you think God died for people who are not white? Well, there's a hard question. I can tell you're stumped. Yeah, he died for everybody. He died for the sins of the world. For God so loved the world. He loved us all. And guess what? He still loves us. So the Bible is giving us just kind of a snapshot of this cat. And he is a mighty warrior. But watch this. But though Naaman was a mighty warrior, he suffered from leprosy. Everybody look this way. Question. Now raise your hand. Who knows what leprosy is a picture of in the Bible? What is leprosy? Yes, ma'am? Exactly. Leprosy is a picture of sin. And so this man, as great as he was, and the Bible goes on to say in verse 2, at this time, the Aramean raiders had invaded the land of Israel, and among their captives was a young girl who'd been given to Naaman's wife as a maid. And one day the girl said to her mistress, I wish my master would go to the prophet or the preacher in Samaria. He would heal him of his leprosy. Now, folks, this kind of dovetails a little bit with last night, but do you know why some of you have not been healed? You don't believe it can happen. You won't do what God's... Listen, and lest I be misunderstood, some of our healing will not be here. Some of our healing won't be until we get to heaven. I have a profoundly handicapped daughter. I have twin girls that are 27. My twins are 27. And one of those twins, her name is Heidi. She's married to the worship leader at Liberty Heights Church, north of Cincinnati. My oldest daughter, Heather, who I'm going on the date with tomorrow night to see Brian Adams, she's married to the worship leader in northern Kentucky at Family Christian Center. Heidi's twin sister, Holly, had an aneurysm when she was just a month old. She's profoundly brain injured. She doesn't walk, she doesn't talk, she doesn't speak. She's fed through a tube. She has no purposeful movement. She can't. You've seen little kids like Holly. She's fed through it. She on a ventilator. Lives in a nursing home. I've always talked to her, though, like she can understand what I'm saying. Does that make sense to you? I mean, I've always talked to her like she could understand. And every time I'm with her, I say, you know, honey, someday it's not going to be like this. Rick, you remember when all this happened. We were together up Landmark. One of these days you're going to walk and you're going to talk, and I believe her healing will take place in heaven. But make no mistake, folks, don't you want to go to heaven? I mean, why would anybody here be pretty, well, I'm pretty sure that I'm saved. I'm 99% sure. And folks, let me ask you another question. If you believe in, for instance, the message that Bridges of Hope promotes and the ministry that Bridges of Hope promotes, why wouldn't you want to be a part of that? I love this lady and these boys. These boys have sat next to you, and they sit there and they listen. And you know what? I can sense it's important to her that her boys are here. It's important that her boys. Listen, folks, I take this stuff serious. It's a big deal to me. I don't mind making you laugh. I don't mind you having a good time. I want you to laugh. Church was boring to me. I wouldn't listen. If we have the most incredible message in the world, why should it have to be boring? Why should it have to be without life? Do you understand what I'm saying? But why, as a parent, wouldn't you want your kid in a church? Well, you know, no, nothing ever happens at our church. Why are you there? Why are you there? Folks, there are churches. Listen to this. Last year in the Southern Baptist Convention. Is this technically a Southern Baptist church, Pastor? In the Southern Baptist Convention last year, there were over 10,000 Southern Baptist churches that did not baptize one convert. Not one. Want to hear something else? Teenagers who attend Southern Baptist churches 3 times a week or more. And I don't care what anybody says, if a kid comes to church 3 times a week or more, they're pretty faithful. That's pretty faithful. Teenagers who attend Southern Baptist churches 3 times a week or more, after they graduate from high school, 91% of them will not go back to a Southern Baptist church. Now, I don't know what that says to you, and I would say it's probably true in every denomination. I don't think it's unique to the Southern Baptist. But I'll tell you what it says to me. Folks, we can be proud and say we've always done it this way. Or we can change or die. And if we don't change, we're going to die. And listen, folks, I'd rather my kids listen to Casting Crowns and Mercy Me and Skillet. I'd rather them listen to those people any day of the week than the alternative. And some churches, oh no, we're not having that in our church. Drums, those drums. You can almost see demons swirling around them. We don't have drums in our church. We're not going to have drums in our church. I guess you would prefer a young man or a young woman who has the gift to play the drums. I guess you would prefer they do it at a bar somewhere. Have you even read the Bible? I mean, even interested in what it says? Praise Him with the cymbals. With the high sounding cymbals, with the loud clanging cymbals. Hold on. Praise Him with the dance.
He ain't no Baptist.
This little girl saw something, this great warrior. She said, look, I wish my master would go. He could be healed. This little girl saw something this great warrior didn't see. Folks, don't underestimate and don't misjudge and don't put down the day of small things. God might have something He wants to say to you through a teenager, a student. There's a little, she's smiling.
I see you over there. I hope my parents are listening to this. Because I tell them that. I tell them that all the time.
You're too cute to get mad at. Look here. The Bible goes on to say in verse 4, so Naaman told the king that the young girl from Israel said, go visit the prophet. And the king of Aram told him, I'll send a letter of introduction for you to take to the king. And so Naaman started out carrying gifts, 750 pounds of silver, 150 pounds of gold, 10 sets of clothing. Verse 6, the letter to the king of Israel said, with this letter, I present my servant Naaman. I want you to heal him. You know what, folks? This guy thought he could buy a blessing. This guy thought he could buy healing. You can't do that, y'all. Some of you think your money gives you a right to, huh? Can I just land there for a minute? My daddy used to say, with shekels come shackles. But I will tell you this, if you don't tithe, your opinion means nothing to me. Because you're a thief. You're a God robber. If you don't tithe, your opinion means nothing. You're eating for free. And by the way, you'll be the first people to complain when things don't go the way you think they ought to go. If you earn money, you're supposed to tithe. Look at this. So this guy thought, you know, with my money, I can buy this. At verse 7, when the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes in dismay and said, this man sends me a leper to heal? Am I God that I can give life and take it away? I can see he's just trying to pick a fight with me. But when Elijah, the man of God, heard the king of Israel had torn his clothes in dismay, he sent the message to him, why are you so upset? Send Naaman to me. You want to know the truth? Send them to the man of God. And by the way, the real man of God can't be bought with gold and silver. Huh? So Naaman went, verse 9. He went with his horses and chariots, waited at the door of Elijah's house, but Elijah sent a messenger out. Boy, don't you know this ticked him off. Elijah didn't even come out to see him. In other words, you don't impress me. I'm sending the messenger out to you. Go and wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan River. Your skin will be restored and you will be healed of your leprosy. But Naaman became angry and stalked away. That's even better than walked. It's like, just to lay you out. Quit being a thug. Got me some green lights under my car. I got the green lights under my car. You just as well say, hello, I'm insecure. I want everybody to see my big old wheels, my little loud stereo playing music that's by gang members with microphones. I want them to see the them little green lights all up in there. Where's the daddies at? You gonna let your daughter get in the car with him? This boy came to my house and blew his horn.
I better put this microphone down because I'm fit to get all up in here.
If you come to my house and blow the horn, you better be delivering a pizza. You ain't picking up one of my daughters. You ain't picking up one of my daughters. And if you walk to my door with your pants sagging, I got a nail gun. I'll staple them around. Huh?
Yeah, let me tell you another little something. If you hurt her, I'm going back to prison. Back.
Huh? So, folks, do you see where this is heading? I'm going to land the plane here, but I want you to see all this. Naaman, here is a desperate man, or one would think, he has leprosy, and he is given this remedy. But he gets mad. You know what, folks? Don't act like that's not you. Don't act like that's not you. You know what you're doing that's wrong. You get mad at everything. I had a lady come to my office and she said, "We're going to talk." Cheryl, would you get me some coffee? Sister, you may talk to your husband that way. You're not talking to the preacher that way. She said, "Well, I don't have a husband." Well, there's a shock. She said, "Well, I've been married to 6 losers." You've been married 6 times. I know who the... And it's always somebody else's fault, isn't it? Why can't a man say, "I lost my wife because I was a cheating scoundrel"? And why would a guy ever hit a woman? Is this on radio, TV, the internet? I hope it is. I have a word for it. Is this the internet campus? People watching? If you hit women, you are a punk. P-U-N-K. Punk. And you're afraid of a real man. That's why you hit women's. Come over here and hit me. We'll be on the news tonight, me and you. We'll be out here in the gravels. And you know, the thing is, I'd probably get whooped. But you know what? You'd have to do it, folks. It's pride and it's ego that somehow makes you believe I'm entitled to treat people the way that I do. Now, here's what's unfortunate. Everybody listen. Look this way. I don't want to lose you. Here's what's unfortunate. The people who really need to hear this think this message is for someone other than them. They think it's for someone else. You know, before you know it, I'm thinking tomorrow night I've got this date planned with my daughter. And I don't know why daddies don't do that. I don't know why daddies don't keep doing that. Well, my daughter's married. Mine is too, but I still take her on dates. I still take my daughters on dates. I like to do that. And you know what? If I were to say, truthfully, one of the things that brings the greatest joy in my life is for my daughters to walk with me with their arm inside of my arm or lay their head over on dad's shoulder. That's a big deal. I sang at a wedding not long ago that "I Danced with Cinderella." I danced with Cinderella, and before you know it, she's not that little girl. She's grown and she's gone. And pride makes you miss a lot of things. Pride keeps you from recognizing, folks, this world is not our home. It's like being generous. I don't know why some of you just sit on your money. God wants His money in circulation. Listen, tithing is not God's way of raising money. It's His way of raising us. God owns everything. Let me ask you a question. How many of you believe God owns everything? How many of you believe that? If you believe that, then is meeting your need such a hard thing for Him to do? Now, think about this for a minute. He can't meet your need until you have one. You know, if I start tithing, then I'm going to have this need. Good. He can't meet your need until you have one. Create a need. Now, here's what I want to show you, and then I'm going to give you these thoughts, and we're going to pray. But I don't want you to miss it. Verse number 12, aren't the rivers, and he's asking, you know, you want me to go this dirty river. He's asking, aren't the rivers of Damascus, the Abana and the far better than any of the rivers of Israel? Why shouldn't I wash them and be healed? So Naaman turned and went away in a rage. Truth is going to have an effect in your life. It's going to change you for the better. And you know what, folks? People that leave get mad. I'm mad. I'm leaving. You know what the honest situation is, and the honest answer is, a lot of people come, and when their sin is confronted, they can't handle it. And so they have to make it about the pastor. They have to make it about the church. And listen, folks, I honestly don't mind saying what nobody else will say. But you folks who have listened to lies and have read lies and not only not stood up for your church and your pastor, but have succumbed to those and propagate, shame on you. Confound it. Why would you do such a thing? You know, Dr. Rawlings was rough on us, Rick. He was, but I'll tell you one thing. He didn't talk behind your back. If he had something to say to you, he did it man to man. And the purpose was to be redemptive. Now, can I just give you the Cliff Notes version of the rest of the story? He finally decided to obey the man of God. He finally decided to obey the God of the man. And he went to the river, and he washed himself, and guess what? Just like the blind man last night, he was made clean. Are you taking notes? I hope you are. Write this down. Pride will always rob you of a powerful existence. It will rob you. Listen, pride will never permit authenticity, because you go through your whole life, trying to be somebody you're not. That's not the way to live your life. Don't do that. It's, you know, and I, when I see these, like these little girls, the little teenage girls and stuff, I absolutely despise the pressure that Hollywood and the fashion industry and the cosmetic industry puts on our little girls, especially our little girls. They say, unless you're pencil thin, unless you're, you know, you've got all this and you have nice, that somehow you're just not as, listen, the next time, and it's not just girls, guys battle this too, but the next time you stand in front of the mirror and you wonder why you don't look like somebody else, or you feel ugly, or the next time you do that, or maybe the next time you feel like, you know, maybe even God doesn't love me, if that ever happens, if you ever believe that, I want to ask you a question. If that's true, give me one other possible explanation for Calvary. Why would Jesus die such a horrible death if he didn't love you? And he loves everybody. He loves people that don't love him. Romans 5:8. But God commended his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. For scarcely for a righteous man. Listen, folks, God died for us when we were unlovable or unlovely. Folks, do you realize, honestly, some of you, your whole life is about the gym and, you know, golf, and your whole life is about Tupperware parties, and boy, you talk about a rag job. Having to babysit kids while the wife's having a Tupperware party. I would rather give birth to a flaming porcupine while lying on my back in an igloo undergoing a hemorrhoid attack with my nostril hairs on fire. A little lady in our church, she could never witness to anybody because she said she was too shy, you know. We had this Tupperware party years ago when I was married. We had this Tupperware party, and this little lady that couldn't say nothing about Jesus, and I'm watching all these kids that are possessed with many devils. I told him right away, you might jump on the drapes at your house. You're not doing that at my house. Uh-huh. And people talk about kids. Well, kids are going to be kids. That boy has sat there like a perfect gentleman the whole night. You want to know why? Because he knows what the rules are. Daddy's had a couple of come to Jesus talks with him. You know why your kids are, hey, because you don't run them. They run you. They're children. Huh? You don't negotiate with kids.
Let me tell you, man, if you spank me, I'll call Child Protective, man.
While you're at it, ask him how to get this boot out of your back end. Because that's where it's a going. Ha! So this lady who can't talk to anybody about Jesus, she's standing there and she's got this little spoon, a really skinny, it's got a little spoon on this skin.
Yes, it's small. And she says, girls, and she's holding up a ketchup bottle. She says, you know how frustrating it is to not be able to get the last little bit of ketchup out of the bottle.
And I'm standing in the doorway. I said out loud, oh, yeah, I just fall apart. I should have never said that. All those women. If you can't get ketchup out of a bottle, you don't fall apart. Stick a French fry in there and pull it out. It'll come out, you know. And you know what's amazing? I see some of you even tonight. And by the way, where's this visiting church group at tonight that came from another church? Pastor, thank you so much for coming and bringing these young people. God love you, man. God love you. Thank you, Pastor. We're so honored. We're honored that you came. God bless all of you. I love you and I like you. Thank you for coming. And you listen, remember what I'm saying. Folks, actually, remember what God's saying. I wish some of you, here's what some of you have done. Your whole life, you've believed what that bully in the seventh grade said about you on the playground. Or your dad. Or your mom. And do you know some of you have dads and moms that are dead that still rule your life? I heard this the other day, and I'm not saying this to be edgy, although I'm edgy. But I'm saying it to tell the truth. I heard a dad call his daughter a whore. He said, you're nothing but a little whore. Now, you may not know this, but if I had time to sit down with you, I would prove to you that what you have just done is you've pronounced a curse over your daughter. Kids live what they learn, and they give what they got. Your words shape your world. Life and death are in the power of the class. Tongue. Life and death. Why would a daddy call his daughter a whore? Now, you know what needs to happen here? Miss Natalie, would you come and help me? Can I tell you, and quit popping that gum. You've done that one time too many now. For some of you tonight, maybe you're sitting there and you're thinking, you know, I'm glad, boy, I'm sure glad my husband came tonight. I'm sure glad my kids are here. And honestly, when you say that, you've missed it. God has something for you. Some of you have been mad your whole life.
Well, nobody knows how I was treated.
That's over. That's yesterday. Well, you know, that's not fair. Look this way. Do you want what's fair? Who wants what's fair? Folks, I don't want what's fair. Brent, I want grace. Listen, I got news for you. If I get what I deserve, just like you said this last night, I thought about this today. You said, people are used to seeing me come in my work uniform, and so often I come to church and I'm just dressed in my work clothes. You see, you come to church. Bless you. bless you, bless you. You come to church. God don't care whether you wear blue jeans or a t-shirt. That don't mean nothing to God. You don't have to wear a coat and a tie. This brother gets right off work and he comes and so kindly. And I want to tell you, I'm going to speak something over you, brother. I mentioned this the other night. But we had talked about this outside. I said, Pastor, what is that? He said, well, that's a prayer tower. And the first night, there was no light in it. The next night, it was lit up. You want to know why? Because he saw that. Now, did they pay you to put a light in there? Are you still taking notes? Still taking notes? A need seen is an assignment given. You know, somebody needs to put a light in the tower. He didn't say that. And you know what he told me? He said, I wanted to do that. And here's what you basically said, if I heard this right. I wanted to do that because I didn't want have to worry about my pastor climbing up there and maybe falling when he's got a church to lead. Is there any way tonight you'd be willing to just check your pride? And just say, Lord, here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely. You're altogether worthy. You're altogether wonderful. Is there any way you'd be willing to do that? Is there any way you'd be willing to say, you know what, I need to ask my husband to forgive me. I need to ask my wife to forgive me. I need to ask my kids to forgive me. I need to ask my parents to forgive me. My oldest daughter that I'm taking on this date tomorrow night, she says, Dad, one of my biggest fears is that you'll die all alone in a hotel room. All by yourself, Daddy. You won't have anybody around you. You'll die in a hotel room. You may have a heart attack and you can't call nobody. And I try to comfort her. I'm never alone. I'm never alone. You're never alone. By the way, there's a world of difference in being alone and being lonely. Honestly, folks, there's a lot of people that would never understand this statement. But I got a German shepherd. His name is Caesar. I don't think he's saved. But I love my time with that old dog. You want to know why? He loves me. Now I just made the connection. That's the doctor. That's your boss. Doctor, I want to tell you, I'd be a cripple today. I would be a cripple today were it not for a chiropractor. I'd be a cripple. Of course, the problem with my back is my front. And I wasn't sure the first time I went. He told me to lay sideways, and he laid right next to me. I said, now, hold on, brother. We don't roll that way. We're honored you came, doctor. Thank you. By the way, I'm honored you came. I'm honored you boys came. I'm honored you ladies and gentlemen came. I'm glad you came. But you know what it's going to take tonight for you to ever be free and to live the life God wants you to live? And see, we all like different things. I like Diet Dr. Pepper. I like P.F. Chang's. My favorite place in all the world, E. P.F. Chang's. I like to shop at Casual Male. Why do you like to go there? Because they have clothes that fit. I was telling the pastor the other day, if I could live anywhere, you know where I'd like to live? I'd like to have a cabin somewhere. Maybe a bedroom or two. Just a cabin. That's all I want. Big kitchen. Indoor and outdoor. So I can have my buddies over. And a big yard for my dog to run. And a bed to lay my head. And a place to sit out on a porch. where I can take my Bible. And when I stand behind that desk, I'm not giving out some cold, lukewarm, rehashed. I'm giving out hot bread. Right out of the oven of heaven. Hot bread. Don't you want hot bread? Would you be willing to trust Christ tonight? Would you be willing to give Him a chance in your life? Would you be willing to do that? I want us to bow our heads. Miss Natalie's playing, and she's done such a good job, and our musicians and sound people have done an incredible job. Even the light people who are determined to burn my corneas out. Thank you all. While our heads are bowed, and Miss Natalie, could you play a little softer? My throat is just a little sore. I want to ask you a question. I'm not asking you if you're a Baptist. I'm not asking you if you're a Pentecostal. I'm not asking you if you're Jewish or Catholic. I'm not asking you if you're Church of Christ. I'm asking you this question. If you died tonight, do you know for sure that you're going to heaven? Do you know that? And if your answer is yes, here's my question. What are you depending on to take you to heaven? Well, the church. No, the church didn't die for you. There's nothing redemptive in the power of a church. If you go to heaven, it is because and only because you have placed your faith and your trust in the finished work of Jesus Christ. And by the way, you better hear this. God has never saved you if He hasn't changed you. That means if you are what you were, then you ain't. That's bad grammar, but it's good theology. I want to ask you tonight, and now it's going to take some of you just swallowing this pride thing. How many folks would hold up your hand and say, Jamie, I really don't know for sure that I'm going to heaven. You know, Jamie, I go to church and I'm religious, but I am not 100% sure that I'm going to heaven. But I care enough about my soul to ask you to pray for me. How many friends would just hold up your hand right now in the name of Jesus? Hold up your hand and say, that's me. God bless you. Hold it up real high. Anybody else? God bless you, honey. Let me ask, God bless you, sweetie. I love you, honey. I talked to you before church. You made me laugh the other night. I saw you fighting back that smile and finally got the best of you. But now God's breaking your heart, honey. Because tonight's the night you're going to give your life to Jesus. Tonight's the night you're going to trust Him as your Lord and your Savior. Oh, and that beautiful smile is going to be even more beautiful. How many others? How many others? How many others? Now, I want to ask you, this is a tough question. How many of you'd hold up your hand and say, Jamie, there's some pride in my life tonight that doesn't honor God, that doesn't bring glory to Him, that I need to mortify, that I need to kill, that I need to put to death. Jamie, there's some pride in my life that don't belong there. And I admit the message was for me tonight. I don't know who else needed it, but I needed what I heard tonight. God spoke to my heart. There's some things in my life that need to be different, and God spoke to my heart through the message tonight. Would you take your hand in Jesus' name? In Jesus' name, hold it up as high as you can. Hold it up as high as you can. There's hands all over the building. Just hold it up everywhere. I can't even call all the hands. God bless you, friends. You can put your hands down. Let me ask you one more question. One more question. How many of you'd hold up your hand tonight and say, Jamie, I'm saved and I'm sure, but I know I could be doing more for Jesus than what I'm doing. Jamie, I know I could. I know I could. How many of you'd hold up your hand and say, Jamie, I readily admit that I could do more for the Lord than what I'm doing. God bless you, sweet friends. If you raised your hand, would you look this way? If you raised your hand. Would you look right here if you raised your hand? I want to ask you to do something a little different tonight. I'm going to ask you to get right up from where you sit. And there's so many people who's going to come. I want you just to come. If some of you would like to come up here and just kneel up around me, right up this way, and leave room for the next group that comes. But if you raised your hand, here's what I want you to do. I want you to get up out of your seat. And as humble as you can be, I want you just to fall on your knees. If you're able, you may not be able. You may not be able to kneel. You may need to stand. That's fine. But I want you to come and just say, Lord, here's my life. God, whatever I can do to serve you more. I was thinking about you, teacher. You're the only Jesus that some of those kids will ever see. Doctor, you're the only Jesus that some of those people will ever see. Coach, you're the only Jesus some of those kids will ever see. Pastor, you're the only Jesus that some the people that you encounter may ever see. They can't see and they can't hear cursing and flipping people off and blowing your top. They can't see that. Kind of a hardcore message in a way tonight, wasn't it? Would you get up out of your seat? I don't want you to wait. I want you to grab a spot at this altar and just say, Lord, here I am. Enough of me, all of you. Pastor Dwayne, I know you're going to come in a minute. Honey, I want you to wait right there with your mama. Come on, grab a spot up here. Take some time. I love you, sweetie. I want you to remember what Jesus is going to do for you tonight, okay? I want you to remember this forever. I'm not into embarrassing people, and I don't think you're a bit embarrassed. I think you're actually comforted now in your spirit. Is this Mama right here? I want you to pray with Mama. Mama, I want you to pray this in your daughter's ear. Baby, I want you to pray this from your heart. Will you do it right now? Right now. Dear Lord, I know that I'm a sinner. And I can't save myself. But I know you can. And that's why I came. With my mouth I confess. In my heart I believe that Jesus died for me. And I place my faith. And I place my trust in you, Jesus, in what you did for me on the cross of Calvary. I accept you, Jesus, as my Lord and my Savior. Please accept me. In Jesus' name. Now, I don't want anybody to look except that little girl. Did you pray that tonight, babe? You believe Jesus did what he said he would do, honey? God bless you, honey. While our heads are bowed, I want you to just talk to the Lord for a minute. Now, I want to ask you to do something a little different. You may not be used to this. Let me tell you what this next part is for just a moment. This is called a symphony of prayer. Are you listening? A symphony of prayer. I want you don't have to yell, but I want you to pray out loud right now and talk to your Heavenly Father right now. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to take a few minutes just adoring Him, worshiping Him, thanking Him, praising Him. Pray it out loud right now. Just pray it out loud right now. Hear that? Symphony of prayer. Pray it out loud. Pray it out loud. Talk to the Lord out loud for a moment. Oh, Father, thank you. We love you. We adore you. We praise you. Oh, Jesus, we ask you tonight to do what we cannot do. God, I pray somebody tonight would forever sense victory in their life, would forever be free. God, I pray you'll bless those tonight whose hearts are broken. Jesus, you're doing a great work in here tonight. You're working in the lives of some young people. Sir, I'm going to speak a word over your life tonight. God told me a minute ago, and now I'm going to speak it over your life. You better listen to what I'm telling you. God has something he wants you to do. And for some reason, you've just not thought enough of yourself. Now it's time for you to believe what God said. You are a child of the King. He loves you. He wants to use you. Quit making excuses and start doing it. Listen, you could do a whole lot more than what you're doing, and God wants you to do that, and you better hear that word. You better hear it. He loves you. When you finish praying, you just go back to your seat. Help somebody up next to you. God bless you. God bless you. Well, as Miss Natalie plays, would you all look this way? Would you look this way? Thank you all again. I love you and I like you. I hope I get to see you again. You pray for me. Tomorrow morning early, I'm headed off to Louisville. And because I'm just going to spend the day with my daughter. Thursday, I hop a plane to Jacksonville, Florida, where I speak at Journey Church in Fernandina. Then off to Virginia Beach. Then the Great Landmark Church in Cincinnati on the 25th of this month. September the 8th at The Gathering, 2 miles from Dollywood in Pigeon Forge, wonderful church, The Gathering. I'll be there Sunday, September the 8th. But I love you and I like you. You all are precious to me. I want you to think about doing this. I know pastor's going to take up an offering for the ministry. And there's so many things you can give to. I want you to hear this. I don't have an air-conditioned doghouse. I don't live in a mansion. I live with friends. I drive a pickup truck. So I want to tell you something. My heart's cry is to be able to bless. All I want to do, this is my golf game. This is all I'm praying I'll be able to do for the rest of my life. I want you to pray two things for me. Number one, I'm tired of traveling 250 days a year. I'm tired of that. You pray that one of these churches that God opens the door would let me come and be their pastor. Number two, if you would, pray that our needs would be met. I want to go to Africa. I want to go to Africa again next year 3 times. We're planning a trip in May to Kenya. I'd love for you to come with us. I'd love for you to come. It's about $4,000 a person, though, because we take a day trip to London. We have a wonderful time, but we take a day trip to London, have a little sightseeing, go to the mission field. The last day, we want to do something for all the people. We take a state-of-the-art safari, which is just one of those things in your life that's on the bucket list kind of thing. Let me give you one final thought. These bracelets, they say, you are only one choice away from a different life. Lady from Starbucks bought 100 of these the other day, and she said, I'm just putting them in a cup so that anybody who wants one, it says it all. You're only one choice away from a different life. School teachers buy them for their kids. Parents buy them for their children. Youth pastors buy them for their youth department. It just says it all. Now, I'll tell you what I'm doing with the revenue from these. For $50, I can buy a water filter that provides 100 gallons of pure water to families and people around the world that have no water. Now, I want to ask you to do this. I asked you to do it the other night, and I don't want it to be long. This is going to be very brief. If you could help people who have no water without costing you one dime, would you be willing to do that? I'm going to tell you how to do it right now. If you are willing to receive 1 to 3 family-friendly texts per day from places that you shop, you'll fill out a little profile, you'll get coupons, you'll get discounts. These advertisers are paying Life Building Ministries, Praise Fest Ministries. They're helping us go to Haiti to provide clean water, to help stop the human sex trafficking around the world. And here's how you do it. You take your phone right now, grab it, and instead of dialing a phone number, you dial 7 with 4 zeros, 70,000. 7 plus 4 zeros, and then in the body, all lowercase, LBMIN, hit the space, put your 5-digit zip code, and then hit send. And with that, we will immediately start to receive funding. And you, everybody can do this. It costs you nothing. By the way, if you get one of the texts and you don't want it, you don't even have to open it. Delete it. But by signing up, you're helping provide water to people who wouldn't normally have it. It's been a joy to be here with you. I love you and I like you. I'll see you at my table tonight. On the way out. God bless you, everybody. I'll see you soon. God bless you.
Isn't God awesome? Amen. Real quickly, as our ushers are getting ready to come, tonight you have an opportunity to partner with Jamie Rago and his ministry. We've always been a church that has believed in blessing those who bless us and blessing those who don't. Amen? Here's what I'm going to ask you to do tonight. Okay? Tonight, this is your last opportunity to give to Jamie Regal's ministry. Let me tell you how I was blessed when I first met Jamie. I'd heard about Jamie, okay? But when I met Jamie, I remember asking somebody, where does he live? And they said, in his car. I said, what? Yeah, he stays in his car. I mean, he's in hotel rooms when he's traveling and preaching, but when he doesn't have a place, he's usually in his car, but now he's with his with friends, with his children. That's really, but that's very few days out of the year, okay? Very frugal in his spending. I've gotten to know Jamie very, very well. Jamie and I have become very close friends. God has just blessed me with this awesome relationship with him. I can tell you that when we sow seeds tonight into his ministry, that God will honor those seeds with much fruit. Okay? From day one, almost 7 years now at Bridges of Hope, here's kind of how we've lived. If you can't pay your bills, help somebody else pay theirs. God honors that. Okay? If you'll sow into people's lives, you'll begin to reap into yours. I can tell you, I'm living proof. Okay? All of my life, that's all I've ever known. Tonight, you have an opportunity to do that. You can give by check. If you're writing a check, make it to Bridges of Hope Fellowship. We're going to write him one check tonight before he leaves. If you can give cash, give cash. No children whatsoever, okay? We're not accepting children because I don't think he's wanting to take any with him, okay? Yeah. Now, I've tried to give him Dwight, and he won't even take Dwight. I'm like, hey, he would make a great yard man, you know? Landscaper, house cleaner, something. And he said, no. He said haircuts would be way too expensive. I'm just kidding. I'm sorry. I love my son. I have to tease him all the time. Here's the deal. What if you say, Pastor, I don't have check or cash on me right now. We got you covered. Go online at gethope.info. You can give right now in the memo box, put Revival. Or you can download our Secure Give mobile giving app. And in the box, just put the amount and then put Revival. Okay, that'll go straight to Jamie. You say, I don't have any of that technology stuff. If you have a debit card and you want to give by debit card, stop out by the table. We have the app on our phone. It'll scan your card. You can put in how much you want it to be. You'll have to sign it with your finger and put in your email address, and it'll email you a receipt immediately. Okay? We have ways that you can give so that you can bless the man of God. Here is my desire. That when he leaves this place tonight, his entire budget for the week will be met. You say, how much is that? His budget each week is $3,000. That's what we're asking God to do, is to provide that budget for the rest of the week. When he goes to this next meeting, he can start on a clean slate. Okay? Him and I are actually, I'll go ahead and tell you this. We're getting ready to partner. Transformation Ministries International, that's our personal ministry, is getting ready to partner with Life Building Ministries. That's Jamie's ministry. In doing, we're getting ready to start putting together student conferences, senior adult conferences, marriage conferences, singles conferences. We're getting ready to team up to make a difference and to plant more churches, not just in America, but around the world. We're making plans now. I'm so excited, I can't stand it. For years, God has put in my spirit to be able to give $100,000 a year to help fund new church plants around the world. It's about to become reality. I'm excited. Pray with us. As you give tonight, you're going to help make this vision possible, okay? Let's honor the Lord in our giving. Father, in the name of Jesus, right now, thank you for every gift that's being given. Lord, there's some tonight who are giving sacrificially. Father, those that are watching by our internet campus, right now, God, are able to go and click that little donate button up in the right-hand corner of the screen. And God, you're going to use them to sow into Jamie's ministry right now. Father, tonight, help us to be difference makers in our giving tonight.